Now, let us find an equation related to the output characteristics. Now, in order to achieve that, we know that in all device analysis, we have to solve 5 basic equations. We already have discussed this, and those 5 equations are 2 transport equation, 2 continuity equation, and Gauss law. Now, if you look at the device, it has a inversion layer as well as it has a depletion layer. So this is your depletion layer, and this is your inversion layer. However, apart from that, you have 2 voltage sources or 2 electric fields inside the device. One electric field is from gate to bulk, that is in the x direction from gate to bulk. Another electric field is from drain to source, that is in the y direction. So if you consider both x direction and y direction electric field, then you will see that your transport equations will be having x direction electric field, y direction electric field. Continuity equation also will have x direction and y direction electric field, and the entire device analysis will become highly intense in terms of mathematics. And we need to analyze the entire situation in a 2D geometry, because you have x and y, both type of components present for most of the parameters. But as I have said, this will make the entire discussion very intense in terms of mathematics. So our target would be to reduce the 2D situation into a 1D situation by taking suitable approximations. Now, before that, the approach that I will take is, we will consider a small region, a dy region, and then we will consider the voltage in the channel region to be vy, and then we will integrate, we will try to find the equation for vy, and then we will integrate the solution from y equal to 0 to y equal to l to get the equation for entire channel. This is the approach that we will take up. And in this case, I have shown you a 3D figure of the device. It is not the entire device, I already have told, it's just the channel portion. So the 3D picture will help us to understand the width of the channel, which is W in this case. So let us start taking the approximations, and let us start with transport equation. Now, when we will solve the transport equation, we will only consider electron. We will ignore the whole concentration, because in the inversion layer, the majority carriers are electron, because you have taken an n-channel MOSFET in this case. So the majority carriers are electron. The whole concentration is very, very negligible. So in the transport equation, we will only consider electron. We will ignore hole. Secondly, we will only consider drift current in this case, because under strong inversion, diffusion is negligible. As we are considering a strong inversion case, your diffusion component will be negligible. So we will only consider electron drift current. So the transport equation will be solved only for electron current and drift current, that is electron drift current. Similarly, when we will solve the continuity equation, we will only consider electron, because hole concentration is negligible in the inversion layer, as we are considering n-channel MOSFET. And current for any electron at any cross section is equal to the drain current in the y direction. What does that mean? So if you take any cross section, that is, say this is your cross section, okay? So if you take any cross section in the channel, that is here. If you take any cross section here or across the channel, the electron current is equal to the drain current in the y direction. Your drain current is flowing in the y direction. This is your ID. Or in other words, you can say that IY is constant with respect to y. That means the current in the y direction is constant with respect to y. So that will help us to simplify the continuity equation. And for Gauss law, we will take gradual channel approximation. Now let us understand what is gradual channel approximation. So to understand that, let us first write the Gauss law for both Ex and Ey. So it will look like this: del Ex by del X plus del Ey by del Y is equal to rho by epsilon. Where rho is the space charge including both depletion and inversion charge. Now in this case, we will consider that del Ex by del X is much higher than del Ey by del Y. That means the rate of change of electric field in the x direction will be much higher than the rate of change of electric field in the y direction with respect to y. Rate of change of electric field in the x direction with respect to x is much higher than rate of change of electric field in the y direction with respect to y. Why is it so? Because in practice, you will find that your EI EY value is much smaller than your EX value. So your EY is actually much smaller than your EX. The reason behind that is the oxide layer here is very thin. So the thickness of the oxide layer is very thin. It's say around 0.1 micron. Or of the order of 0.1 micron. So if you apply same potential between gate and bulk, say VGV, and if you apply same potential between drain and source, that is VDS, then your electric field value in the x direction will be VGV divided by 0.1 micron. Because the thickness of the oxide is 0.1 micron. For y direction, it will be VDS divided by 1 micron because your channel length L is of the order of 1 micron. So definitely, this value, that is your EX value, will be much higher than your EY value. That's why you can consider only del EX by del X and you can neglect del EY by del Y. Now, this indicates that the channel conditions are not changing drastically in the y direction. Because we are neglecting this, so we can consider that the channel conditions are not changing drastically in the y direction, rather they are changing gradually. There will be no drastic change in the y direction. Whatever change will be there, they will be gradual. That's why we call it a gradual channel approximation. Now in the next lecture, we will take all these approximations and we'll solve the necessary equations in order to find the equation for drain current ID. So we already have discussed the approximations related to the MOSFET that we will consider for the output characteristics. So let us start with whatever we have discussed already and then we will proceed for the output characteristics of MOSFET. and we will try to develop an equation associated with the same. Now, so far we have discussed regarding the common bulk configuration, and the reason behind this was the analysis and the explanation is very similar to the MOS capacitor. So in that case, we can take the understanding from the MOS capacitor directly and can develop the equations for MOSFET. However, in practice, we will find the configuration that we use is common source configuration. And in order to convert the common bulk configuration to common source, we will use these three basic equations. So in common bulk, we have VDV, VGV and VSV. To convert them into common source, we'll use VDV is equal to VDS minus VBS, VGV is equal to VGS minus VBS, and VSV is equal to minus VBS. In order to start our discussion regarding the equation of output characteristics, the approach that we will take is we will consider a very small element dy in the device, and then we will try to develop an equation for this particular region, and then we will integrate over the channel, over the entire channel, in order to find the equation associated with the entire device. To make the discussion even simpler, we have drawn another device structure focusing only the DY section. So this is actually the same device structure, but we only consider the DY width. So in this case, the width of the inversion layer is taken as T, the width of the oxide is T0, JY is the current through the inversion layer from drain to source. Then we have also taken a connector, N plus connector, which is nothing but source in our device, and then we have connected bulk in common. Now we already have said that the voltage, the channel voltage associated with this inversion layer is VY. That's why we can consider a source VY connected with the source. A voltage source VY connected with the source terminal. And we also know that VY is equal to VSB for Y equal to 0, and VY is equal to VDV for Y equal to L. Now if we write the charge equation in this DY region, which is QIY, then the equation will be something like this. QIY is equal to minus C0 VGV minus VTY, where VTY indicates that VT has an effect of VY, which is the case in this particular situation. So your expression for VTY will be VFB plus phi T plus VY plus gamma into phi T plus root over phi T plus VY. So this equation we already have seen in our previous lectures. Now the equation for the current ID will be W into T JY. W is the width of the channel, T is the width of the inversion layer. We are considering this area because current is flowing from drain to source, so we are considering only this area. That is, for the channel, the width is T, as it is shown over here. We are considering only DY region, and the width in this case is W. So it's like something like this. So this width is W, so the area will be W into T. That is what it is written. JY can be written as QNY mu NY EY, where NY is the concentration of charge, mu NY is the mobility, and EY is the electric field in the Y direction. Now if you put this equation in the ID, if you put this term in the ID equation or replace JY with this, then you will get a term like this, where TQNY has a dimension of charge concentration per unit area. If you look at the dimension, or if you try to find out the dimension of this term, this is nothing but charge concentration per unit area. And here we are only considering the inversion layer. So the charge concentration is definitely the inversion charge. That's why we can replace this term with minus QIY. The minus is because here we are considering N channel, so the charge will be negative. And the area under consideration will be, in this case, the gate area, because we are considering the charge in this case, which is because of the potential that we apply in the gate. So the charge under consideration in this case will be area of the gate. So your equation will become ID is equal to minus W QY by mu N by EY. Now you can replace the value of EY with minus del VY del Y. And we know that QIY, that is inversion charge, is also is a function of channel voltage, that is VY. Now let us take this del Y in the left hand side and do an integration over the entire channel, that is Y equal to 0 to L. So your equation will become ID is equal to, sorry, ID integration del Y from 0 to L is equal to W integration QYY mu NY del Y. In this case, the limits will be VSB to VDB, because when Y is equal to 0, VY is equal to VSB. When Y is equal to L, VY is equal to VDB. That is what we put as the limit in this case. Now, if you look at the mobility across the entire limit, what we can do is, for the sake of simplicity, we can take an average of this mobility as mu n dash or mu n bar and take this term out of the integration. So your equation will become W mu n bar, and you will get a L this side because of this integration term. So ID will become W by L mu n bar integration VSB to VDB QY del VY. Let us replace the value of QIY with this one. So what you do, you also put the value of VT over here and then replace the value of QIY. So this will be like this. The equation will become like this, and a minus sign will appear because QYY itself has a minus term. Now this minus term in the ID equation represents that your ID is in the negative Y direction, which is the case. So your ID is actually flowing from drain to source. Now if you perform the integration, your equation will become like this. The integration is not very complicated. You can do it in your home, and you will find that you will get an equation like this, which is not very simple. You have a square term as well as you have a term which has a power of 3 by 2. Now this expression is valid until we reach the saturation, that is till the point when QIL is equal to 0 at VDB is equal to VDB3. Now let us consider the VDB3 is nothing but VDB set in this case. So we have just changing the value of VDB3 with VDB set. In the previous lecture, in the third case, we have seen when VDB is equal to VDB3, the QIL was equal to 0. So you can say that this particular equation is valid for VDB less than VDB set, because after that, the channel length modulation starts. So the effect will not be the same. However, if you ignore the channel length modulation, then the same equation you can use for VDB greater than VDB set as well, just by replacing the VDB with VDB set. So that is what we have shown over here. So if you neglect the channel length modulation, then your ID will be the same equation, more or less. So that's why we put an approximate sign. So your ID will be approximately equal to the same equation where you replace the VDB with VDB set. Now we know at VDB set the slope of the curve is zero because it is more or less saturated. That means if you do a derivative DID by DV DB, then this derivative term will become zero. So if you perform this operation over here, DID divided by DV DB, and if you then equate that with zero, then you will get the value of VD set. But as the equation is a bit complicated, what you can do is you can take this equation from where we started. If you look at the equation here, that is where we started. So you can consider this equation and then do a DID DV DV, and then you can write the value of this at VDB set is equal to 0, which also indicates QI at VDB set is equal to 0 because your VDB is the upper limit. So as per mathematics, you can write this. Now if you do the similar operation, you will find that QIL is equal to minus C0 VGB minus VTL is equal to 0. Now your QIL will be 0 at VDB set, and in this case your QIL will be 0 if VGB is equal to VTL. Now you can write VGB is equal to VTL, and we know the value of VTL, which is nothing but VFB plus phi t plus VDB set plus gamma root phi t plus VDB set. Now from this equation you can get the value of VDB set, then you can put this in the same equation in order to get the expression for ID. This is one way of finding the expression for ID. However, the entire expression now is in terms of the common bulk situation. Now what we can do in this case is we can put VSB equal to 0, that is source to bulk voltage is equal to 0. Now if we do that, we can use the source and bulk terminal interchangeably in this equation. And this particular operation will lead us to a common source configuration just by putting VSB equal to 0, because VSB equal to 0 means the source and bulk terminal are shorted. Now if you remember, initially I have shown you the common source configuration where source and bulk terminal both are shorted. So we have done the same thing, we have put VSB equal to 0. So this all VSB terms will be equal to 0, and we can write VGB is equal to VGS, VDB is equal to VDS. Here also VDB will be equal to VDS, here also VDB will be equal to VDS. Now if you do this operation, your ID will become something like this. Now in this case also you can see that the expression is not yet simple. It has 3 by 2 power term. Now in this case we have to take an approximation as per mathematics, which says if 1 plus x whole to the power n is your term, then you can write it as 1 plus nx if x is much less than 1. So 1 plus whole to the power n is equal to 1 plus nx if your x is much less than 1. Now we also have a situation like this in case of this term. So we can write phi t plus vds whole to the power 3 by 2 is equal to phi t 3 by 2. You just take phi t common out of this expression to make it similar to 1 plus x, and this will become something like this. Phi t whole to the power 3 by 2 is into 1 plus vds by phi t whole to the power 3 by 2. And then if your vds divided by phi t, this term is much less than 1, then you can write phi t 3 by 2 into 1 plus 3 by 2 vds by phi t. Now multiply phi t 3 by 2 with both of the terms, then it will be phi t 3 by 2 plus 3 by 2 vds root phi t, because you have a phi t over here. And then if you multiply phi t to the power 3 by 2 with this, it will be root phi t. Now just put this term in place of this term, then your phi t whole to the power 3 by 2 and this phi t whole to the power 3 by 2 will get cancelled. This 3 by 2 and this 2 by 3 will get cancelled, and you will be having gamma vds root phi t, this term, right? So your equation will be something like this. Now this equation is for vds less than vd set. So if you rearrange this equation a bit, just take this term along with this one and take vds common, then the equation will be something like this. Id is equal to minus w by l mu n bar co or c naught into this term into vds minus vds square by 2. But you have to remember two approximations. One is vds less than vd set, and another is we have taken vds by phi t much less than 1. So your vds should be less than phi t or 2 phi f. Phi t is nothing but 2 phi f, we already have discussed in one of the previous lectures. Now if you look at the equation and if you rearrange it further, then you can write or replace this term with Vt0. Vt0 is the threshold voltage without body effect, or you can say Vt0 is Vt for VSB equal to 0. Then if you replace the term, then the equation will become Id is approximately equal to minus W by L mu n bar C0 or C0 into VGS minus Vt0 into VDS minus VDS square by 2 for VDS less than VD set. Now this equation is much more simpler than the equation that we started with. Now one thing that you should also understand in this case is, if you take the 3 by 2 power law, then your output characteristics will be something like this, as it is shown over here. However, if you take the square law approximation, that is if you remove the 3 by 2 terms from the equation, then your output characteristics will be something like this, wherein you get a higher current compared to the actual output characteristics. Now in order to compensate that effect of extra current, what people do is they adjust the mobility mu n dash. So you adjust this value of mu n dash little lower, so that the curve that you have in case of square law approximation will come down to a curve like this, which is approximately equal to the actual one with 3 by 2 power law. As per 3 by 2 power law, whatever you are getting, that is closer to your measured value, and in order to bring the square law approximation curve near to that 3 by 2 power log curve, what you do, you adjust the mu n bar mobility, and then you will find that your curve is closely following the 3 by 2 power log curve. That is one thing one should understand in this case. However, in this case you have a much simpler ID, so you can very easily get the value of VD cell using the same technique. That is, you take the derivative of VID with respect to VDS, and then you put this term is equal to 0 because the slope at VD set is equal to 0. So you take the DID by DVDS, then you will get an expression like this, which is simple, the derivative is not too complicated. And then you put DID by DVDS is equal to 0. You want to find out DID by DVDS is equal to 0, and that will be 0 if this term is equal to your VDS. Now if this term is 0, your VDS is nothing but VD set, which is equal to VGS minus VT0. Now in order to find the IT set, that is saturation current, you just replace VDS with VD set in this equation. So your ID set will become minus W by 2L mu n bar C naught VGS minus VT0 whole square, and that is for VDS greater than VGS minus VT0. Now your VD set is equal to VGS minus VT0. Now this equation is for VDS greater than equal to VD set, and your VD set is nothing but VGS minus VT0. So you can write your equation, this one is VD for VDS less than VGS minus VT0, and this equation is for VDS greater than equal to VGS minus VT0. Now we already know the value of VT, which is equal to VFB plus phi T plus gamma root phi T, and gamma is equal to root 2Q epsilon S Na by C0. So these values are known. Now if you consider common bulk configuration, then VTB is equal to VFB plus phi T plus VSB plus gamma root phi T plus VSB. So if you take VTB minus VSB, then you will get the threshold voltage for common source condition, which is nothing but VTS, or you can write VT, which is equal to VFB plus phi T plus gamma root phi T plus VSB, and then you can apply the same value in those equations. One thing you should remember, these equations are also valid when your VSB not equal to 0. That means if you consider the body effect, the equations will be more or less valid, and you can replace this VT0 with VT, that is this value. So you will find in books, in terms of in the place of VT0, they write VT because it is also valid when your VSB is not equal to 0. And in somewhere you will find that VSB is written as minus VBS. So these things you will find in books, and you should not get confused with all these terms, because these are just changing the terms as per their convenience. Then you should remember that all these equations are solved for n-channel MOSFET. So this is your equation related to the MOSFET. And if you look at the physical significance of square law approximation, we assume that this depletion layer or depletion charge is constant from source to drain. I repeat, in square law approximation, we assume that the depletion charge is constant from source to drain as shown over here. However, the variation in depletion charge from source to drain is considered in 3/2 power law. The moment we take square law approximation, we assume that this part is constant. Now, your inversion charge is changing from source to drain. If total charge prediction is same and depletion charge prediction is less, then definitely you will find more inversion charge in your prediction. I repeat, in square law approximation, we assume that the depletion charge is constant throughout, as it is shown over here. And even in square law approximation, your inversion charge is changing from source to drain. That is, it is decreasing from source to drain as it is shown over here. Now, if your total charge prediction is constant, that is, the total charge that you predict using the square law approximation, if that is constant, which is constant by the way, and depletion charge is reducing, then you will find using that approximation, actually your inversion charge is increasing. You will get more inversion charge. That means your current will be more. And that's why your square law approximation predicts a larger current, as it is shown over here. We already have said that square law approximation predicts large current because of this physical significance. So if you try to explain this effect, why square law approximation predicts more current, then physically this is the reason, because you are predicting that the depletion charge is constant. However, you are not predicting that the charge is reducing, total charge is reducing. Your total charge is same, but your depletion charge is constant. That means you will get higher inversion charge in this prediction. That leads to a higher current.